Well, hello, everyone. I'm here today with David Roodman. Just kind of before we start, you can write your questions and we'll answer them kind of at the end. You can just type your questions and we'll address your questions kind of at the end. Well, David, first, thank you for being here. It's a pleasure to have you. And I'm going to start kind of introducing you for those that don't know you. I bet everybody that's listening probably know you. So David is a mathematician by training. Now, after he finished his training in mathematics, he devoted his career to study public policy. And when I do studies, like very regularly, he's written 2 books and published numerous articles. He's the recipient of the Stata Inaugural Editor's Prize for the Stata Journal. And if you look at David online, if you look for citations, he's going to be in the top 10 on downloads, on citations for his work. And his work can be characterized as being very rigorous, mathematically, computationally, providing tools. And I would like to point out, from as a person that consumes some of his work, a work that has a lot of clarity. And it's really clear. It's really well written. The programming he does for his Stata code is really well written, really functional. Anyhow, it's a pleasure having you here, David.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So let's start with the question that we usually start these interviews with. It's kind of like, get us started. Like, as children, most people dream of becoming doctors or firefighters or ballerinas, not economists or public policy experts. How do you find your way into this career? How did you get into this line of work?
For me, the path was quite unusual and unplanned. So it all looks good in retrospect, but I did not know how it was going to work out. And one sign of that is that I've actually never taken a course in economics or statistics. And I don't have a degree beyond a bachelor's. Now, my bachelor's is a pretty good one for statistics. It's mathematics from Harvard. But it's been a strange but ultimately wonderful ride. One important thing about me that I think shapes what I did is that I'm a child of divorce, and it was a pretty rough divorce. And so I grew up with two parents who really disagreed with each other on some fundamental things. And I think perhaps that created or heightened a sense in me that if I was going to take a stand on anything, I really had to think it through carefully first, because it was dangerous to just quickly jump to a conclusion. I also grew up with mathematical propensity. I liked doing math. And when I was pretty young, my dad introduced me to computers. But I also had a mother to whom the feminist movement of the 1970s spoke very strongly. And through that, I got a strong sense of, being a full person in society means taking a stand on political issues. And so I think I came into adulthood feeling like I was interested in math and computers, and that was fun. But it wasn't just enough to, go be a computer programmer. There's also, I wanted to think about important social issues. And so when I graduated from Harvard with my math degree, I got a fellowship to study at Cambridge and also study math in England, and pretty quickly lost interest in my program and started reading books about economic issues and inequality and environmental issues, and felt like somehow this was my future. But I didn't feel like, oh, I want to go get a PhD in mathematics. I was actually kind of economics. I was kind of suspicious of economics at that point as a field that was too caught up in its own mathematical models and divorced from reality. Whether that was justified or not, I don't know.
Well, some economists think that. Like, if you read like Ronald Harry Coase's like a Nobel Prize winning lecture, he calls it blackboard economics. And actually he won Nobel Prize. And there's like this in economics, I don't know if you read it or not, like there's the Coase theorem, and it's supposed to be a theorem and it's mathematical. Well, he never wrote a theorem. He never wrote any math.
Anyhow,
where you make me think. I have a question for you, just kind of following that train of thought. And in a sense, tell me if I'm wrong. I feel that there's kind of this path for researchers. Like, you do your bachelor's, then either you go to an institution where you learn about research and then you do your PhD, and then you're beholden by this path, right? Like this traditional setup. And in a sense, you didn't follow that path. And in a sense, I think that gives you more intellectual freedom. Would I be wrong saying that?
I think it yeah. So just to clarify what you're saying, I never did go and get a PhD, as I guess I said that. You know, I became interested in writing about public policy, and I came to Washington, D.C. as a young man and worked for think tanks. And so, yes, without any grand plan, I avoided the academic path. And I think there were pros and cons to that. When I later began working alongside more academically trained people at the Center for Global Development in my 30s, I sometimes did think, you know, they have been trained in a way that I have not, to look around and find creative combinations of questions and data that have not been brought together to generate new evidence. And I wasn't good at that. On the other hand, it gave me the freedom to do things that most other people didn't do. And over time, I found out where my doing other things was actually useful. In particular, often I was in situations where there were researchers arguing with each other about whether A causes B. Does foreign aid increase economic growth, for example? And I didn't want to go do new research on that question. I just wanted to understand existing research really well, decide whether I believed it. And so I did things that were kind of impolite and probably would have been unwise if I were on a tenure track job. Like I would go and tear apart other people's work, sometimes ratify it, sometimes not. But it's sort of intrinsically impolite. And that actually is how my first Stata program came about, XDA Bond 2. I was at the Center for Global Development, which is a think tank here in Washington that focuses on how rich country policies affect poor countries through foreign aid and trade and so on. And there was a lot of controversy in the early 2000s about whether foreign aid had been statistically shown to increase economic growth in the receiving country, using a lot of growth regressions, mostly panel regressions. And one of the papers in this debate used something I didn't understand at all, which was different GMM. And it was run in, I think, RATS, I think that's a statistical software system. But my organization used Stata, so that's all I knew. And I know it used system GMM, which is an expansion, augmentation of difference GMM. And at that time, Stata had a difference GMM command, which it wasn't quite what I needed in order to replicate the study. But I really felt that I needed to rerun the study myself so that I could decide whether to trust it. So I started hacking Stata's XDA bond command. And got to a point where, as often one often does in a creative programming project, where I had to leave the original thing I was hacking behind and build my own thing. And I don't think that that's the sort of thing I would have done if I had been academically trained.
Yeah, and I also think it's liberating in a sense because you're not insulting your advisor or your field, or you're not going to get tenure, or suddenly if you like kind of go, I think. I don't know, there's a feeling of reading your work that there's a lot of freedom of like, I'm going to ask the question that I'm interested in. I'm going to pursue the route I'm going to pursue. And I did it my way, kind of a deal. So anyhow, that's kind of a feeling I get. Just going a little bit back, like, how did you get acquainted with Stata? How was like your first contact with Stata? Where does your Stata, first contact with Stata come to be?
Yeah, my first contact, I think, it was through my wife, who was doing a master's in public health and also had taken off a year. She's actually an MD as well. So she had taken off a year between residency and internship, during which we went to Vietnam, which is where she was born. And she managed to work with a nonprofit called the Population Council to run an experiment there, comparing the quality of healthcare in public clinics and private clinics in a certain setup. And then she had all this data analyzed. And I forget if she started analyzing it in Vietnam or when we got back to the States and she was at Johns Hopkins. Possibly it was in Vietnam, in which case we probably would have been using a bootleg copy of Stata 6.
as long as you use maybe, data, it's fine.
Yeah. Or maybe it was when we got back, but I think it was Stata version 6. And so I just got a little bit of exposure. At that point, this was, you know, 20 years ago. I sort of knew what ordinary linear, OLS was, but had never really done it myself. I'd never hardly run a regression myself. And then a couple years later, I did start at the think tank I just mentioned in 2002, the Center for Global Development. And there it was declared that Stata was our official software package. And so that became you know, my first statistical language.
Your go-to. Now, you mentioned XT-Abona. I was going to ask you about how it came to be. And so you kind of like gone there. What about CMP, which is really popular too? Like, what was the motivation? How do you get started on the CMP project? I guess for our audience, what is it?
Right.
I guess
you could also. Yeah, exactly. So it was pretty much the same way. There was an academic controversy, and I characteristically felt that I needed to dig way deep and rerun the original research to decide whether I believed it. In this case, the controversy was over whether microcredit, which is what I wrote a book about and what I was studying, reduced poverty. There was an influential study, pretty much the most prestigious impact study at the time. This came out in 1998 in the Journal of Political Economy, finding that microcredit in Bangladesh, which was the country most famous for microcredit at that point, did reduce poverty, especially when given to women. It was by Mark Pitt and Shahid Konkar. It's a non-randomized study, using a household panel, about 2,500 households, if I'm remembering right, across about 80 villages. And then there were three follow-up rounds. Then that study almost immediately was followed by a challenge in sort of a gray literature, unpublished challenge from a young academic named Jonathan Mordock. And it was one of these debates where people on the outside see there's a lot of arguing, but it's very hard to figure out what's going on because it's very technical and you have to invest a lot of time to understand. But I felt like I really needed to if I was going to be an expert on the impacts of microcredit.
And it's very politicized, right? It's also a very hot topic in the sense that people feel strongly about it. It's not something people feel lightly about, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, there are a lot of dimensions to it. Partly it's about a lot of good stories can be told about microcredit, about women who got a loan and changed their lives, and people come attached to that. But then the question is whether that story is representative. It literally became political in Bangladesh when the prime minister of Bangladesh actually tried to take on Mohammed Yunus, the founder of the Grameen Bank, politically.
Yep.
That's a long story. So this key paper has a rather complicated methodology in which there's an instrumental variable set up. The first stage is modeling whether a woman in a household and whether a man in a household to decide to get a loan, and if so, how much they borrow. So that's something that we could model with a Tobit model. So there's a range of variables. You could borrow 1,000 taka or 1,000,000 taka, but you can't go below zero. So there's a kind of censoring effect that's bounded on one end. So we had a first stage that modeled that decision to borrow as Tobit. And then a second stage that modeled the impact that you were interested in, whether it was how much your person earned or what household consumption was, whether you had a job, this kind of thing. And sometimes that would be modeled as a regular, uncensored variable, or if it was, whether the girls were in school, for example, was a binary variable. So you could have a model where you've got a Tobit first stage and a Probit second stage. And so this is like a two or three equation system with potentially correlated errors and a lot of censoring going on. And the equations in the appendix that spell this out were very complicated. And I decided I needed to implement them in Stata by writing my own custom maximum likelihood estimator. And I was really struggling to get it right. And there was a point where I knew I had a choice. I could either try to match exactly what happened in this paper, or I could zoom out and write a general command. Because there's a lot of cases where you can replace three equations with one matrix equation.
Yeah.
And thinking about it in that simpler way actually makes it easier to write the code and make everything work. And that was the birth of CMP. It was a program where you could create as many equations as you wanted, and they could be Tobit or Probit or other kind of things like ordered Probit. It grew over time. And so I was following an intuition that it might be easier for me to make a more general tool, and also just sort of more aesthetically pleasing and more useful to other people if I created the general tool.
The general tool, and that it's a beautiful design, by the way. Just FYI, it's because you need to think about system of equations and how it comes together and how to think about the problem. So
yeah, anyhow, I guess I want to say two things. One is I kind of knew I was stumbling onto something beautiful. Like I don't know, wasn't sure if I was inventing it or discovering it. And I was kind of confused why it didn't exist already, because once you see it, it seems so right. And now there are Stata tools like it, and in many ways go beyond it. Wonderful tools, SEM and GSEM, really amazing tools. I guess the other thing I want to emphasize is in both commands, it was through writing these commands, XT-Abona2 and CMP, that I learned the econometrics in them. I didn't understand them really beforehand. And it was then that I was able to write papers about them as a teacher.
Yeah, and I'm just by the way, the fact that you come from a different angle makes you write about it for somebody that comes from a different angle too, right? If you're like inside, again, it's going back to the same topic. If you're like in the path and if you're in academia, you use the jargon, you use the language, sometimes it's more confuses people more than clarifies. And anybody that's read anything that you've written realizes that it's coming, okay, yeah, it's going to be accessible to me. And it's, yeah, if you're mathematically literate, I guess, it's kind of like the minimum requirement. So, and can I go back a little bit to CMP and that, because I wanted to ask you about another command, but I'm just going to, this time seems to be running out, man, such a shame. But anyhow, about your book about microfinance, and there's something I want to touch on that I find interesting is, I guess, more for the general audience, you've explored public policy and you've gone at it from like different angles. Now, what's your assessment of how you should tackle a public policy question? Like if you were to like meet a young researcher, okay, this is how you should tackle this problem. These are the methods. And again, what are the warnings you would give a young researcher looking at public policy? Okay, be careful with this, or like, don't fall into this trap. Like, just kind of somebody pursuing like public policy, what advice would you give them, I guess?
That's a really big, challenging question.
From your experience, I guess, because you've tackled these problems and the methodological discussions you've also...
The first things that comes to mind, which may not be necessary for a typical academic, is to beware of simple truths, simple claims that microcredit always reduces poverty, or that third world debt is killing 17,000 children a day, which was once prominently claimed. That there, almost everything in public policy involves trade-offs, and it's your job to understand them. And often understanding the trade-offs requires an interdisciplinary mindset. There may be something that a policy that makes perfect sense from an economic efficiency point of view that makes terrible sense from some other point of view that's better understood with another discipline. And so I think it's just to recognize that disciplines can get, and one point is to recognize that disciplines can get in the way of a full understanding of a problem, but that if you want to really get to the best answer, you have a responsibility to cross those boundaries.
Yeah, that's now there's this going back to your microfinance book there's this new, like, well, not new, it's been there for a while, like experimental methods, and obviously they're in vogue. Is there any like warnings or like things that you find appealing or unappealing of these methods?
I think what you mean is that there's been what's called an economics, I think, was the high quality revolution. I think that might be the wrong term. But, you know, I mentioned back in 1991, I avoided economics. I was kind of suspicious of it. I think since then, there has been more of a movement towards compelling empiricism. You know, there has, within development economics, there's been the rise of randomized trials, which, of course, just generated some Nobel Prizes. There's also been more interest in other rather compelling research designs like regression discontinuity. By and large, I'm in favor of those. I mean, I think it's always good to be skeptical of any fad. I think I've seen at least one paper written that is a skeptical replication of a microcredit randomized trial. So even randomized trials, there's lots of discretion in how the results are analyzed and reported. And it's good to bring skepticism. But in general, I'm in favor of this movement. And there's an irony there because, you know, as I said, often I've written these commands in order to replicate existing studies. And when I write a piece of software, I like to design it well and explain how it works. And the result has sometimes been, and I would say maybe especially with XDA Bond 2, that I've made it easier for people to implement methods in which my own trust has declined. I'm not sure. So sometimes I'm not sure if I've made the world a better place or not.
Well, it's very transparent, right? Like, it's there, and people, anybody that's interacted with you in Stata list kind of knows this. Like, you're it's out there, you respond, you talk about it. I think it's very open, I guess. I'm gonna end with something a little bit lighter, I guess, and something that I find very interesting. And I'm gonna tell you a random story. Hopefully it'll make sense at the end. I hope. There's something called Spanish contradanza. And now contradanza made its way to Cuba, and it's kind of the origin of some of the rhythms that originated salsa dancing, which I love. Now, contradanza comes from country dance, which is actually coming from English folk dancing. So I know from like reading your CV and what you've been doing or your website, looking at that you enjoy English folk dancing, which makes us like soul brothers because I enjoy salsa. They're one and the same. English folk dancing and salsa are one of the same things. So can you talk a little bit about English folk dancing? What is it, where your interest arose, and anyhow, because kind of like...
Yeah, I don't know a lot of the history, but our first records of this dance form, English country dancing, emerged in the 1650s. It's in the same family tree, not only with salsa, but with square dancing, which is something that more people are familiar with. Usually it's done in couples in a set, whether it be a square or a rectangle of three couples. And the emphasis is less on body movement, what you do with your hips or your shoulders, than on making geometric patterns, you know, back going back to back, circling left, circling right, this kind of thing. And it's something that I think is, you know, in some ways I think of it as a folk tradition. It's 350 years old at least. But it's also clearly strongly influenced by the inventions of the printing press, because the dances became so complicated and so numerous that people couldn't remember them all, and it was important that they could be written down, and that in turn facilitated more complexity. Anyway, so it's a tradition that's really thrived in England, but also France and Italy and I think elsewhere, in the 1600s and 1700s, died out in the early 1800s, and then was resuscitated about 100 years ago. In this country, in the United States, as well as in England.
So you enjoy the patterns and the symmetry and the geometry, but that's kind of like your...
Right. If you think about beautiful music, love music that moves you, and then imagine doing geometric forms with it that fit the music so that you feel like the story of this tune is going through your body. And then you're doing it with your friends, right? People you're looking at, engaging with, touching. It's a very rich experience. It feels like
it is.
I imagine it's like being in a chorus where the music is flowing through you.
Oh, you're creating by movement. So yeah, I tell you, I could tell you some salsa stories and there's some math always there, like in music and in there's math. So.
And I should say my dad, you know, who introduced me to math and computers, is one of the leading writers of dances in this form today.
No way. That's kind of cool.
Yep.
So here's a question from YouTube and probably let's close with that. So is that what recommendations do you have for others teaching themselves data and analytical methods? Like what recommendations do you have for people teaching themselves?
Well, if you're trying to understand, you know, something that's already built into Stata and you're just trying to understand what it is, obviously it depends a lot on the specifics. In general, I believe in simplifying things. So if you want to apply some new command to a very complicated problem and you don't quite understand it, first try the simplest possible application, maybe with just two variables or one variable, and see if you understand what the results actually mean. And then only gradually build out from there. I sometimes hear from users who give me complicated commands and they want to know why it doesn't work or is this what they should do? I say, start simple and build out from there.
Yeah. Well, David, it's I think our time is up. I think we could do this. We could, yeah, it was super short. I think hopefully we'll get to cross paths soon and talk about many things. I know you'll stay here for a little bit after it ends. Thank you very much. Honestly, it's been a pleasure. And I hope you keep on producing some nice code and some nice books and some nice articles that are like as rigorous as the ones you've been producing and as accessible to the audience that is interested in this topic. So, thank you very much.
Thank you.